Hi again, I did 40 minutes. I'm very aware that it may be difficult to follow, it may be rambling, but just as a caveat, this is just a documentation. It's not a presentation. So don't expect anything other than some surprises, because that's probably the best way to do it. Because I'm not anything but led when I do it this way, if you can understand that. So already in part two, I showed you out the window the gladiolus. They are spring flowers. They were put in about 4 months ago, and I was told they won't flower because, or 3 months ago, I put them in too late. They're bulbs. They need a frost and they come up straight after winter, spring. But it's summer and they're up. You've seen the tomb. When the light shines behind that, it's an optical illusion and it's a hole. The tomb is rolled back. It's also a portal. There goes my truck. Billy D has a white truck, which he thanks God for. I thank God for my truck too. Right. Notice yellow's here and fire is outside. They have the freedom to choose what they want to do. And he chooses me, don't you? See? Would you ever part with a dog like that? So, I talking about the life of Brian. Now, Brian used to have a small dog, and he's renowned. He's in a book. He's in a book. He has notoriety as an old-timer on the West Coast. His role as a hero in the marine industry, the rescue industry on the West Coast, and held very high posts, almost government-assigned posts, running whatever it is they run. When it comes to rescue missions at sea. So the word that the Lord gave me was a necromancy concerning him, because I've remembered what it is. It's sinister, and I'm hardly concerned about it, other than just sharing that the Lord will show his angels what's in your heart and your acts and your deeds. So there is no hiding, and it's just a personal testimony, I suppose, of how, in the end, which we are in, everything will be revealed, truth. So keep hiding, but you'll see that. Some testimony I'm going to bring shows that I don't hide, and that's how you become an overcomer. So when I was looking up the Church of Sardis after I'd watched Billy D, and the Lord showed me that he was the swallow that came into the caravan, and I'd said to Mark, is he the one? Is he the swallow that came into the caravan this morning? And I'd asked him on his channel under that YouTube video that I watched.
I felt like I'd been sort of tricked because I was screenshotting the church and I was putting up a thumbnail for it, and it was just in time, really. I thought that I just realized that I was looking at the wrong church, and I had noticed the rewards, and I'd mentioned that the reward for the Church of Philadelphia was the door, the key, which is pretty clear if you know who Click is. But and the I'll leave the Church of Sardis for Billy D, because he's the one who has that revelation. But I thought I was reading it, and like I got my pen out and I cropped the reward for the Church of, is it Emphasis? And it was to eat of the tree of life. Now, when I was in the Glory Hut, I ate from the tree of life. It was a massive grape, and I was scoffing into it. It was as big as a melon. I also had the vision of the lake and then the bushscape, which I've just mentioned again, with the exotic tree, like it wasn't a native tree, that raised out of the ground, and the swallows were flying in and out of that tree. And then I had the episodes with the swallows, the one that was at the door, and yesterday morning the one that come in. And then I've been shown the Lord has found Billy D, who is the angel of the Church of Philadelphia, without a doubt. I'm absolutely sure he is. Absolutely sure he is. Because of the PVC fence, because of the truck, the caravan, and the fact that he has no home. My home was given up for the Lord. And it had a nice PVC fence, and on that fence was a number. And the Lord showed me full circle this year. Because I was stubbornly not looking up Strong's numbers. The first time I ever looked up a number in Strong's was the first puppy born on New Year's Day that Glory had the timestamp. So that's why this testimony that I'm bringing at Christmas is about the timestamps of the puppies born, this time on Christmas Day. And it's a kicker, and it's coming. That's your three-course meal. I've done the starter, and I will do the main, and then I will do the dessert. Three sets of three. Just like the Lord showed me in the bathroom dream. After the bathroom dream, the Lord said, there's three sets of three. And then there's the fun game that I play outside. And I saw him kicking the three tip-top containers. Whether this is another layer, but I am doing the three sets of three again. Three is an important number. It's a God number. I know that. So I just believe that this is probably going to drag out, but I'll show you this. So here's my date. Well, I was waiting for it to upload. You can read my notes. YouTube history, part one and part two, which is what I'm doing now. No, I'm doing part three. So the part one is Angel of the Church of Sardis. Part two is my other ramble upload and about my YouTube history. And this is part three, YouTube history. I'm going to go up and down my YouTube history, I think. So I haven't looked at this yet, but I've talked about the three kings. I've used that thumbnail before. We know who they are in Revelations. I'm wondering whether I will show you the life of Brian. And that's from my conversation yesterday with Mark and also Sesame Street. It's not easy being green. That's the original. See? The original. I'm not very happy with this light. I'm trying to take this slow for you guys. Remember, this is not a presentation, this is a documentation. So I've watched over my videos. Just want to show you that one, which I showed you, the Three Kings. And as it says here, I'll say it, Belshazzar, what's the guess? That's him bringing the COVID to the Messiah, which is not our Messiah, Life of Brian. There's a reason why I put the image of that sweatshirt up with the broken bricked wall, because my husband's broken too. One with Candy. A Candy. Remember our first dog, Candy? He smashed it against the wall. And the other was the Vril, when he was a drone flying over a river and he saw raised the letters V-R-I-L, and then a wall appeared and he had a rock in his hand and he threw it. So the life of Brian. Okay, so we've got the gladioles, which I think that's what they are. They're bulbs, gladioles. And that's what Cleck's got now in his sort of like YouTube set. I'm going to go up and tell you what the Lord showed me about that. So this morning, and this is why I'm posting this, we have the Bush Telegraph again, and this is the third one that she has mentioned of this lady called Gladys. That's what this is about. Now Gladys, from what I believe, is a lady in America who forbids people from singing. She has some place in the government, and she has this post again. Now the Lord reminded me of, and I've shared it, a cult that the Lord sent me into. I was there because I watched a Joseph play on a Saturday night. On the Sunday the Lord sent me to their services. They did everything decently in order. It was a controlling cult. They took the letters to the churches on how to run their gatherings, with one person prophesied or speaks in tongues, another person has the interpretation of tongues. So the service was literally a very strictly run, one word in tongues, one interpretation. Then the pastor would say, stand, you can clap for the song, sit for the song. I interceded the whole day for the church. The Lord gave me a word, which was the word that he gave to the scribes and Pharisees when they rebuked the people. They talked to the disciples and said, can you shut the people up? You know, this is a holy place. Because it was Palm Sunday and they were making a lot of noise over Jesus, the triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And the Lord Jesus had an answer for them, and it was that if I was to shut these people up, I could make the stones cry out. So that was the word that I brought in the evening to some youth that were in that church. And then later on, a year or so later, they tapped me on the shoulder, the same people. They said, after you come to the church, the whole church disbanded. The pastor was in sin. We're still going strong. Now, they strictly went out and evangelized every Friday night, and now they are led by the Spirit and filled with the Spirit. So that's all about, that's what the gladiolas are. It's, that's what this is about. That's why Click has them in his stage set. That's why I have them out of season growing, where I've had someone say they won't grow. They won't flower. They'll just green up and then die and wait till next year. That's why Karen Brewer is pushing the point of this lady called Gladys, because the cult and what the Lord has given us, the who are in the truth and turned up, those angels, we can break the power of the cult, the one world order, this new Messiah, his power. We have been given that authority. I'm testifying, and you know, I haven't done in the name of the Lord. There's very few great things that I've done. That's one of the great things that I've done up till this point. I haven't been released. So now we're going to go back. Okay. We talked about the chalice. So this is the first thing that I saw. These three clips here, all I've done is played a little bit, so they're on my history. The lost and found 12 tribes of Israel. I'm not saying that's going to be a good teaching, but I am saying that the Lord is talking about the 12 tribes of Israel. And that is a very important part of what he's showing us by showing us another angel to the church. And the timing is perfect. And the chalice, the revelation of the chalice that Cleek has had, is confirmed by my dream, where I'm taking the lower track and I just walk in and see that giant and I get thrown out, and then a chalice appears and I throw it at his forehead like David. So this is called Days of Noah, and it's about hybrids. So I mentioned in the last couple of days my truth are here, duck or Borg, as in cyborg. So we're talking, I see Trump, I see transhumanism, whatever they're doing. The details don't matter, it's just the parade. The confirmation from the Holy Spirit is what matters. So here we go. Very old videos came up of Trump. Not Trump, of Hillary Clinton when she has her glitch. And it's posted by Jonathan Cleek. I think it's about 9 years ago. And then there's a glitch. Now this is, I've linked this. He got information about a patent, and in the patent they specifically have this picture of Obama, and this is that CIG or that technology. So I linked that earlier because that's where the Lord was taking me. So he's reminding me of this, which I saw full circle. I am coming now because I've seen that as watching the parade. And he's talked to me about the giant. And this is the only one that I played anything off. You've got the 12 tribes. You've got Gladys. Gladioles. How they're trying to stop you from singing, crying out to the Lord, worshipping him, the joy. Because they've got joy, joy, happy, happy, but they want to crush our joy. And that's what the gladiolas are. So that's confirmed. I don't need to play that, but I'm going to play the very beginning of this, and you'll see the giant and the trellis and the 12 tribes, just in the first couple of seconds. This is all I played.
What about when Joshua and the nation of Israel entered the land of Canaan? They were instructed to wipe out every man, woman, and child of certain tribes. I've talked to some people whose entire rejection of the Bible and God rests on this portion of the biblical text. This video is for those people. What no one ever mentions when recounting this issue is that according to the story itself, the tribes that they killed were non-human hybrids called the Nephilim, and they were huge. They had iron beds 13 feet long and 6 feet wide. It says that the Israelites were like grasshoppers in the sight of the Canaanites. These Nephilim...
Enough? So, I'll be watching that today. Now, I want to keep on track. So, we've showed you all that. Let's have a look at the life of Brian. So, the life of Brian... Oh yes, oh yes, oh yes. This is the other thing that's important. So, duck or board, quantum conscious, my trefa that the Lord showed me. Also put this one up, which I haven't watched. Visiting 1984's Band-Aid. Now, is there a movie called 1984? There is. So that will be interesting. We Are the World, Live Aid. You too. You too. Click. You too. And I haven't watched this one because the Lord has said suddenly to me, be ready for the things that I have told you will take place suddenly. And I will just show you this. Something is about to happen. I watched a little bit. Benny Hinn. Now that was when the Lord gave me the word, don't get caught in room 8. It's basically infinity, which Jonathan Cleek put on his table, which is in the containers. The Lord, it's the magnetic field. He grinded it into the table. But the Lord said, don't get caught in room 8. And there's two short clips by Sapphire, which is sponsored short films. One of them is called Roommate, and the other one's called about the flatmates and Roommate. And both of them have the same theme, because they weren't told to call their short films Roommate. They were told to create a short film for a competition on Infinity. Yet both of these wee short films that were award-winning were called Room 8, and that's where the Lord took me. So there's a message in both those short films. It's in my testimony. But at the time when there was trouble in the church, which was... I was here, it was a year ago, there were three things that happened. One man was a well-known pastor, young man, and he committed suicide. Another man a well-known youth pastor who wrote books about abstinence and the appropriate way for Christians to courtship, not fornicating before marriage. He was an advocate, and he had clear instructions that he put in a book to help everybody out. Well, he made a declaration that he was no longer a Christian and that he didn't believe in anything that he wrote, which was a big deal. And then we had a problem with Todd Bentley and his wife, and let's just call it lasciviousness, and very many, many, I'm going to say unrighteous, mean Christians, although they might be using the word of God. The way they did it, the way they called him out, was despicable. And then there's Billy, or Benny Hinn, who the Lord gave me a word for, because he came up at the same time. He was, and everyone is in two minds about whether he repented from his prosperity doctrine. The Lord showed me, and I took a book to the Glory Hut. His book was called Something the Holy Spirit. It was a whole book with a dove, and it was all about the Holy Spirit. He wrote it probably in the 70s. And he knew the Holy Spirit. And he has an anointing. And the question is, can they be in sin and still have their anointing? The church is asking that. It is. Because I just looked, and I know that. I saw this, and then when I was looking at the Church of Philadelphia, I looked at somebody's teaching on it. And then I know the year they did it was 2019, and I could tell by they were making conclusions about sin in the church and the letters to the church, and they mentioned prosperity doctrine, and they alluded to all of these cases that I've just shared with you, and how the church is, the whole grace movement is incorrect, and incorrectly believes that God accommodates sin and doesn't remove people's anointing. Well, these are all questions that I'm sure the angels to the churches have the answers to, and this is why I'm mentioning it, because I believe that the Lord is leading me to come to some conclusions. And the word that I got, don't get caught in room 8, was specifically for a man called Jeremiah Cohen, who has a YouTube channel who calls people out all the time, and the Lord has shown me his unrighteous judgment and his lack of actual relationship and experience in the Holy Spirit. And Benny Hinn has no lack in that area, in that he was really one of the first to speak on the intimacy with the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, and that was God. And he's had a great anointing, and he went off with the prosperity doctrine, and now he was backtracking. In 2019, we're all wondering if he truly repented. So the Lord gave me a word specifically for Benny Hinn. I got a lot of views on it. It's on my channel. It's called Don't Get Caught in Room 8. So this has come up, and I just watched a little bit. Now, Benny seems to be abandoned by all the believers who knew and know who he is. I think he is finding that he can still minister and have a ministry with the black Africans, I might be wrong, and also the youth. So I've watched enough of this to know that he's in communication with the young, the youth, And he's understanding and getting his head around some of the UN agendas, the truth agendas, the truthers agendas. Okay, so for an old fella in the church, you know, from the old guard, he's on the right track. And he knows that something is about to happen. He does know that. He does know that. Now, the word that I bought for him concluded with him in a hole. His arms are stretched out for the Lord to pull him back up out of this hole. But the Lord says, not yet. You have. See, there's a level of repentance. And the Lord responds to an honest heart. And I still believe he's in that hole. I'm not saying he's not. But I do think that there's hope for Benny Hinn. And you may not like that, but the Lord has shown me clearly that there is. So he's come up. So it's funny because this is the church. Now, this one here, remember I mentioned that the Lord has confirmed something's going on out there. Fire, stop it. That the Lord has confirmed dog, as in God, not saying dogs are God, but that it is not discrediting me to have my dogs as a testimony. The Lord God has done that in my life, in my testimony. So this man called PJ Proudify, I saw his comment yesterday, and it was on the comment, if you pay me, which is a link that I made to Jonathan Kleck when he was looking through clothing lines. And that was when I realized why the Lord had me swearing and saying, F you. And I didn't question it. And I knew that I would never get a follower because of it. I mean, it's a miracle. I have 150 people subscribing. And like I said, in reality, I think only probably 4 people watch. Because you will look and see me swearing. I've done my time as a non-swearer in the church, 15 years actually, not a swear word from me, and just listening to Radio Rema only, no secular music. And now he's given me a ministry of the Pied Piper, which is mostly secular music, and swearing. Why do I swear? Because of the truth. The truth. He's confirmed it. If you pay me, the Lord prophesied it when he swore, and I scribed it and put it up on YouTube. I mean, any idiot knows that they will be discerned as not of God if they swear. So it was God, and it is God. Do you see that? So the dogs don't discredit me. And PJ Proudify, like Spotify, like God's compilation album on Spotify, the Pied Piper. This is one of his posts, because I just thought, well, I'll just double check, because I rebuked him in the spirit and I knew who he was. But I thought I'd check again, and I have checked. He's spoken out once before. And this is his post, and I haven't watched it, have I? It's just him standing there. He's in a car. If you watch it, I'd get a hard time because he's got a disability. But, you know, I'm not kind. I'm not Jacinda. I'm the Lord's servant. And the Lord God can discern love. And, you know, they give you kickback. Well, you know, he's got a disability. You can't say that about him, but yeah, I rebuke him, and seriously. So I've got a testimony here of this heading. Jonathan Cleek, people who shine within don't need a spotlight. Let me tell you about a spotlight. When I went up the mountain, I met the man when I was on a tramp who asked me to come over to Kamara on his land. He was a dock worker. I walked past him and I knew someone was behind me, and there he was sitting under a tree. He was working on a project in the bush, and I said, I'm up the mountain and I don't know what I'm doing from here, but I'm a builder, and I didn't mention God. And he invited me up to the dock hut, and I took a backpack because I planned the next morning, because I stayed. He had a friend there. They cooked me a meal, warm fire. I took my backpack and I went for a walk up the Horden Track. The Horden Track, it's called. It was only a 5-hour track, but I got lost because the actual hut, which was on the map, had burnt down. And the thing is that once I got off that track and I went to Arthur's Pass and I got some internet, I told my son. And that's when he reminded me that there's also like a school hut there, like a tramping hut, the school hut. It's big and accommodates a whole school of St. Margaret's, where my daughter went, the elite school that talks about charity. The Bible changed, charity. You know, the Pope, the greatest of these is charity. It's their Bible, right? The KJV, it's changing. Well, my children, because their stepmother works at St. Margaret's, have always had, and they've told me, they've got the key. Dad's got the key. We go there on holidays. Well, when I went to the Arthurs to talk to my son, when I went up the mountain just to check in, tell him I was okay, he said, Mum, me and Dad went up on that track, I remember it, and I was crying my eyes out because we couldn't find the hut. And my dad was so furious because they'd burnt the hut down. It had burnt down, but they never changed the map. Well, he said they had to sleep outside. The kid was only young. Him and Joseph had to sleep outside. Well, that's what I had to do. I was walking around for 2 hours in circles with a torch, and then I slept outside. I had one of those silver blankets, and it was the middle of winter. It had been snowing that week. There was no snow. There was no rain. It was warm as, not warm, but warm, you know, like 10 degrees. I'm going to finish this real quick. So this is the spotlight. When I laid down, I had a silver blanket over me, no dew, under a tree. The Lord said to me, I'm going to wake you at 6 o'clock. I've got something to show you. So I woke up just before 6. I was looking up at a clear sky at the stars, and the Lord showed me this. See the word spotlight? The Lord showed me this. I saw the stars from above looking down, and they rolled up like a scroll. I saw the moon, and it was like the looking into a slow shutter, like in a camera. It was half and half, and how they go click, click, it was like a camera. It was flat, like a shutter. And one of those stars, when I was looking up at it, the Lord showed me in a vision, it was a spotlight, like Jim Carrey in that movie where there's a dome and everything is a stage. The Lord God showed me the spotlight. The star was a spotlight shining on me, like it was a theatre. And now I'm in the theatre of Jeremiah, and this man has written this. Jonathan Cleek, people who shine from within don't need a spotlight. Well, I'm telling you this. We have a spotlight. We're in the theatre. We have main parts. And you should be thinking a lot about these angels to the churches, because that's what this is all about. This is what the Lord's bringing. He's bringing it to you. He showed you two angels of the churches. And I want to say, the church of Ephesus, at the very bottom, the reward is eating from the tree of life. I ate a grape. The swallows fly in and out of it. I'm hoping to bring my word for the second time that the Lord gave me.